Now muster your troops, daughter troop. They have laid siege against us. With a rod, they will strike the cheek of the judge of Israel. As for you, Bethlehem of Ephrathah, though you are the least significant of Judah's forces, one who is to be a ruler in Israel on my behalf will come out from you. His origin is from remote times, from ancient days. Therefore, he will give them up until the time when she who is in labor gives birth. The rest of his kin will return to the people of Israel. He will stand and shepherd his flock in the strength of the Lord, in the majesty of the name of the Lord his God. They will dwell secure, because he will surely become great throughout the earth. He will become one of peace. When Assyria invades our land and treads down our fortresses, then we will raise up against him 7 shepherds and 8 human princes. May God add his blessing to the reading of his word today.
Let us pray, shall we? Gracious and holy God, as we celebrate your presence amongst us, as we prepare our hearts once again for the coming of the Christ child, as we seek in this season to find your peace, to find your purpose for our lives, might you fill us once again with faith, with knowledge, with purpose, to live out the life you are calling us into. Bless the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts. Might it be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. I don't know about you, but when I was a child, the Christmas season started when the Sears Dream Catalog arrived on the doorstep. Some of you are shaking your heads or dating yourselves as I am. I thought this morning as I was getting in the car, what an interesting marketing technique, right? It's golden pages with all those possibilities and all those gifts. I fought with my brothers and sisters over that one and the less popular Montgomery Ward's book to identify those things that were going to make our holiday perfect. I think Mom hid it from us for a while, to be quite honest with you. And how do you control rambunctious kids, you know, who are just filled with everything? We couldn't put the tree up fast enough. We couldn't put the records. Yeah, we had records back then. Yeah. They're coming back, though. On the TV console thing, whatever it was, stereo sure have gotten small, haven't they? For us, the holiday season was filled with happy memories and with the hope of, in some way, appeasing our parents. You see, Mom and Dad kept this thing called the Santa chart on the fridge, and all of our names were next to it, and all the days leading up to Christmas following Thanksgiving. If we were good, she would put a red check next to every good extra DVD, or at the end of the day, we would evaluate, and then there was the black marker that came out for the times in which we weren't fulfilling her hopes or being good, and boy, did we beg not to have a black check mark, because you see, the Santa chart was up for one reason. When Santa came, he would kind of evaluate, after one review, how much he was going to leave for us that year. So all sorts of saintly promises were made when the black Sharpie came out, hoping that we would get just what we wished for Christmas. You'll note a theater theme for this Advent season, if you haven't already. And just to clarify, the movie posters that are out there, there's one unexpected one that showed up yesterday. I am not Scott's sister, despite the rumors. But here's what, you know, Pastor Larry asked me this year as we were sitting down talking about preparing for Advent. He said to me, you know, how do you prepare a sermon series to tell basically the same story every Advent and every Lent season. And as our bishop said in the video, I completely concur, it's the greatest story ever told. There's no way we can change it or improve upon it whatsoever. We only find creative ways. But a seminary professor one day shared his thoughts, his frustrations about our two most sacred holidays of the year. And I think, the more I think about it, the more I concur. You see, Christmas has become known as a time in which a man in a red suit is going to come and deliver gifts. The Easter season, to most people, is a story of a bunny that comes and leaves chocolate goodies in baskets out the yard or in the house. What if we decided that Ramadan would be about this magical flying elephant that made wishes come true? What if we said that the Passover was about an interesting talking donkey or something else? You see, I think people of other faith traditions, if we tried to take the meaning of their basic stories, their rituals, their festivals, their holidays, and try to rework them in some way, they would probably have a fit, and we would be in hot water. But Christendom, in some way, allows this secularization of their most sacred holidays. Why is that acceptable? So, my appeal to you this year is when we look at Christmas movies, and don't get me wrong, I love Christmas movies. I probably own just about every one of them. That there is in some way an essence of a part of the true or the real Christmas story within it. And my hope is, over this time, as we prepare our hearts, that as we look at clips like we did for Ralphie today in the Christmas story, that we might think a little bit about what the real story of Christmas is all about. So I ask you, what is it that you hope for? What is it that you wish for? What is it that in your mind, in your mind's eye, would make the perfect holiday season? Does it in some way reflect maybe a Norman Rockwell moment? Does it in some way relive the past, either your childhood or the time that you had? Does it mean, quite specifically, that some particular wish must come true, an event must go off in the way that it is? Maybe you just find 1 hour of peace amongst the craziness that tends to evade or invade our holiday season. What's your Christmas wish? For me, my list has changed quite a bit over the years. No longer do I need to look at the Sears and Roebuck dream catalog to find it. But is it truly what I need? I ask that question because, you know, I've spent the week reading through the Old Testament looking for signs and ways in which Jesus, as the Messiah, God with us, Emmanuel, come to the world to fulfill the hopes and the dreams of Israel, met and didn't meet the expectations of the Jewish people. We know from history that not everyone accepted Jesus as the one. And there's a group of brothers and sisters in God, the Almighty, who still await his coming. 2 Samuel 7 speaks of the Messiah being of superhuman royalty. Throughout the scriptures, like in Psalm 45, it's the story of a divine king that comes to be and live amongst his people. Psalm 110, which is quoted in Matthew 22:44, speaks of the king of the world will overcome all of his and his people's opponents and will rest, that all the kings of the nation will bow down at his knees. Isaiah speaks of the Messiah as one who's human, but whose spirit rests beautifully Potter. He speaks of the Messiah as a prophet, as a redeemer, one who would come against Jacob's or Israel's enemies. He would pray and hope that when the Messiah comes, there would be one true world government, and the Messiah would be the center or reign over it. Psalm 22 and others speaks of the suffering that the Messiah must overcome. But even as we read beyond the Old Testament's pages, we find in the period following the canonization of the Old Testament, up to even including Jesus' day, Judaism looked to their Messiah to be a Jewish Caesar. Scriptures even tell us in the Gospels that when Jesus performs the miracle of the distribution of bread and fish to the people, that they want to gather him up and make him their king, but he escapes off in silence. You see, the hope of Israel was a capturing of the past, a time that the Messiah would come in even greater ways than David and Solomon had, and there would be a time of deep peace amongst the world. That the message of Judaism, the message of the Old Testament, the Hebrew Bible, would reign in the hearts, that many would learn of the high God of Israel that would come, that would send his prophet into the world, that they would no longer suffer from oppression, but their blessings and their riches and their faithfulness would be rewarded in some way, with peace, with prosperity. So as Jesus hangs on the cross, as his people speak of him being raised 3 days later, you can see that many of the conditions that Israel hoped for were not fulfilled. Micah 5 speaks of the great warrior that will come. But you see, God always has an interesting way of having a completely different plan than all we'd ever hoped or imagined, doesn't he? There's a saying, people plan, God chuckles. I think he chuckled a lot on this one. But it wasn't our hopes, our wishes of success in whatever form they form themselves into that God wants from us. But we are and were in some way created solely to be in loving relationship with God. And as I read the pages of this book, I find once again the rescue mission that God was on. We don't need many chapters to tell us that we messed this whole thing up. But boy, we certainly seem to have a lot of chapters to tell us of God's presence and coming into our lives. What do you want for Christmas? Has this season in which we celebrate the birth of God in human form become a birthday party for all of us and not for him? It's been my tradition every year to buy a new Christmas album. And this year I bought one from one of my favorite artists, Darius Rucker. If you don't know Darius, he was originally Hootie, from Hootie and the Blowfish. And as I listened to his Christmas album last week, the third song on this album struck me. So I want to play it for you now. I want you to close your eyes and kind of embrace the message of this song and what it means.
Old man played Santa Claus, blew in the town with old Jack Frost. Now he's handing out candy canes and smiles for free. People scurry with their lids, rushing around to buy those gifts that will end up wrapped up underneath that tree.
pray that this Advent season might be a time of preparing our hearts to give Christ the gift he always wanted. All of us, all of me, all of you, in all its forms. Amen. What response will we give to the one who gave everything for us? You can stand, you can sit, this is your time. In whatever ways you feel comfortable, in whatever ways you feel to glorify the Master, the one who died for us that we might have life eternal. Stand, sit, kneel, dance, in whatever way it expresses your relationship with Jesus, I invite you to give him all the praise.
Stephen's minister staff at the chapel. We are there to help.